So we'll move on to this issue of definiteness of ethical human conduct. You know, this is what we are going to talk about in this lecture. So now that we have done a lot of homework in terms of understanding the harmony, you know, in terms of, you know, seeing what is the feeling, you know, of harmony at all levels of our being, starting from human being, the individual, to family, to society, to nature and existence. Now we can talk about, you know, how this feeling will express outside, you know, express outside in our behavior, in our work, in our participation in the larger order. So I have this feeling of relationship in me. I have this feeling of responsibility, you know, in my relationship. Now, how does it express in the world outside? So what is this, you know, expression outside? And that is what we are calling as human conduct. So what is this human conduct? This is what we want to understand. So in the last class, we said that now we have understood the harmony. Yeah, we'll go back to this, Rajulji, the last slide you were saying, yes. So in this module 1 to module 4, we said that we have tried understanding this harmony, the underlying harmony in existence, in human existence, right, at all levels, starting from individual to the whole existence. And then we have talked about these feelings which are born out of understanding of this harmony. Right? And in a sense, we can say feeling of relationship, feeling of mutual fulfillment. Right? Now that we have this, in module 5, we are trying to understand how this understanding and feeling will express itself in terms of our behavior, in terms of our work, in terms of our participation. So essentially, we are trying to understand what is going to be the human conduct. Right? There we said in the last session, in lecture 23, that first we will try to understand the principles and guidelines. We'll go back, Rajulji. Understand these principles and guidelines for ethical human conduct. Once we understand these principles and guidelines on the basis of understanding of this harmony and, you know, feelings in harmony, then we will be able to describe certain things about the human conduct. We'll be able to describe certain things, right, about the human behavior, about the human work, about the human participation. And in the light of these descriptions, and in the light of those principles and guidelines, we can also give certain case studies, right? The specific examples. This case study means the specific examples, right, that take place in the light of this, in the light of these principles and guidelines, okay, of ethical human conduct. So what we will do is not talk about do's and don'ts. You know, we will not talk about these specific prescriptions that do this way or don't do this way. So even when we are talking about ethics, and even when we are talking about this professional ethics, we are not going to talk in terms of giving prescriptions, giving the details, you know, of how to perform, you know, outside, or what to perform outside. What we will do is that on the basis of understanding of harmony and the feeling of harmony, we'll try to work out those basic principles and guidelines, okay, for ethical human conduct. And in the light of that, when you go to perform, right, how it looks like, for that we will take certain examples. So these examples are not giving prescription. These examples are not saying that this is exactly the way it will be expressed outside. But they will show you or help you to see those basic principles and those basic guidelines which will be followed when performing outside in fine, you know, in details. So this we have to keep in mind. So that is what we will do. You know, this is what we will do. That we have talked about understanding and feeling. Then we'll talk about this thought, which has to do with principles and guidelines. Then we'll talk about, you know, certain aspects of this behavior work and participation, which are in accordance with these principles and guidelines. So these descriptions about ethical behavior, ethical work, and ethical participation in the larger order, we will, you know, give just to exemplify these principles and guidelines. So they are specific examples. They are the case studies for these basic principles and guidelines, which we are going to discuss here. And of course, in all this process, the ultimate expected outcome is fulfillment of the individual's goal and fulfillment of the goal as a society that we have been talking about. Yeah. So with this, let's move further. So in the previous lecture, we saw how value-based living naturally emerges out of right understanding that we have seen. In this lecture, we will learn about ethical human conduct naturally emerging out of the right understanding and see how it is definite. So what we are saying is that this ethical human conduct can be understood, and it turns out to be something definite. Right? So let's look at this, how based on understanding of harmony and feeling of harmony. And, you know, ethical human conduct will emerge, which is definite in nature. So when we go to study this definiteness of ethical human conduct, this is important to see that, you know, when we look at this harmony at different levels, then it expresses itself in the form of certain basic things, right? Basic happenings, basic outcomes, basic achievements. And this we have studied quite in detail. So we'll just recall those things for our, you know, purpose here. So we said that when there is harmony at the level of self, what it leads to is a state of happiness within. Ultimately, a state of continuous happiness, you know, at the level of self. Similarly, when we have harmony of the self with the body, what it results into is the health at the level of body. If you want to put it more general, it leads to feeling of self-regulation at the level of self, and it leads to health at the level of body. So these are definite, right? These are definite, and this is what we achieve, right? This is what we achieve when there is harmony at the level of, you know, self, at the level of self with the body. What we achieve is this happiness, this continuous happiness, right? This feeling of self-regulation in the self and the health in the body. So all these are our achievement. All these are, you know, what we achieve. So essentially we will see all these are what is valuable for us, right? What is our values? And what is the outcome of those values, you know, living with those values? Now, when we look at this harmony in the family, which has to do with human-human relationship, right, what it results into is mutual happiness, right, state of trust, fearlessness, and ultimately the justice. All this we have studied, so I'm not going into the details, I'm just recalling them. Similarly, when we have this harmony with the rest of nature, then it leads to mutual prosperity. It leads to prosperity in human beings as well as the preservation of rest of nature. And ultimately, when we have this harmony with the whole of nature existence, then what we have is this coexistence, this mutual fulfillment with entire nature. So at different levels of existence, at different levels of human existence, you know, when we have this harmony, this results into, you know, these expressions, these achievements, right? These values. So essentially, if I can understand this, I can understand that there are definite values with which we have to live, and there are definite outcomes when we live with these values. So we can move to the next slide, Lajulji. Can we move to the next slide, Lajulji? Yeah. So what we are saying is that when we look at this ethical human conduct, right, with this understanding of harmony, this understanding of coexistence, understanding of relationship, then there are different ways in which we can express this, you know, human conduct. Right? Different ways in which we can describe this human conduct. So this is one of the description that we have been talking about. So if you recall, we have been talking about this description of human conduct, you know, of ethical human conduct in module 1 to 4. Particularly in the module 4, we have talked about this in quite detail. That when human being has this understanding of harmony, when it has this realization of coexistence, then how his, you know, activity of the self would look like, how he will express it at the level of body, and what will be the interaction with the world outside, and what will be the result outside. So all this has been described many times. So this is view one. This is one way of expressing the ethical human conduct. This is one way of expressing this ethical human conduct. So I will not go into the details, you know, again. You can refer back, right? So when the self is in harmony, we said that it has to be activated at the level of B1 as well as at the level of B2. As long as it is activated only at the level of B2 and B1 is lying dormant, then this B1 is either guided by preconditioning or by sensation. And then it is in trouble, right? It is in a deluded state. It doesn't have the clarity of what is right and what is not right. And therefore, you know, it goes with all that delusion, you know, whatever it has assumed about the reality, you know, with which it is interacting. And therefore, our behavior, our work, our participation in the larger order is undefined, is indefinite, uncertain, right? And we are in confusion most of the time. And whenever there is confusion, there is contradiction, we are in a state of, you know, unhappiness. But if you want to be fulfilled within as a human being at the level of self, then we have to ensure these three things we said: realization of coexistence, understanding of harmony in nature, and contemplating over the relationship, over the participation in the larger order. So these three things have to happen at the level of self, at the level of higher activity of the self, that is, we are calling block B1. Then we say that if you understand these three things, and you know, when we say right understanding, it includes all this: realization of coexistence, understanding of harmony, contemplation of relationship, of participation in the larger order. So when we have this right understanding in us, that this block B1 is active, then this can become a guidance for block B2. And this block B2 is the imagination that we have been talking about, right? Our desire, thought, and expectation put together. So imagination is now guided by this block B1, guided by this realization, understanding, and contemplation of coexistence, harmony, and relationship. So when this is guided by this B1, then we are in a state of harmony at the level of self, and therefore we are in a state of happiness at the level of self. So by this process, I can ensure the continuity of happiness in the self. With this state of harmony and happiness within at the level of self, now this self can interact with the world outside in a mutually fulfilling manner. So it can behave with other human beings in a manner which leads to mutual happiness, which leads to justice, right? Similarly, it can work with rest of nature in a manner which leads to mutual prosperity. And it can participate in the larger order, which can result into fulfillment of human goal. So all this we have talked about, right? But I am recalling them all. Then if I am ensuring this mutually fulfilling behavior, or if I am behaving in a manner which ensures mutual happiness between me and the other with whom I am behaving, and if I expand this from my family to the world family, it results into an undivided society, undivided human society. And similarly, when I participate in the larger order leading to fulfillment of human goal, from the family order to world family order, it leads to universal human order. So this is the natural outcome, this behavior, this work, this participation in the larger order is a natural outcome of my imagination, right, of my feelings and thoughts which are taking place in this self under the guidance of my realization of coexistence, my understanding of harmony, and my contemplation of relationship. So this is the way in which my conduct will be expressed outside. And this is the total expanse of my living as a human being. My being as a human being in this nature, in this existence, right? Where my family, my society, my village is, you know, something in between. But ultimately, this is the total scope of my living as a human being, total scope of human conduct. So this we have been talking about, you know, again and again in the, you know, last four modules, but now we can put them all together and call it as ethical human conduct. So if you look at this, in a sense, what we are saying can be moved to this next slide, Rajulji. So in a sense, we are saying that it all starts with realization of coexistence and completes with the participation in the universal human order. So if you look at those yellow blocks, you know, yellow kind of marked this thing. Can we go back, Rajanji, to that back slide? Yeah, so if you look at this, it starts with realization of coexistence, right? And it completes with expression in terms of universal human order. So this is the total range, right? And everything else is in between. My right feeling is in between, my right thought is in between, right? But these are the two, you know, ends of human conduct. It begins with realization of coexistence. Right? And you can extend it saying that realization of coexistence, understanding of harmony and contemplation of relationship. And it is completed in terms of my participation in the universal human order. So as I said, as described in the last diagram, it all starts with realization of coexistence and completes with participation in the universal human order. With right feeling, right thought, and mutually fulfilling behavior and work in between. So all that is in between, right? So end to end, if you see, it is realization of coexistence and participation in the universal human order. So this is, in a sense, one of the way of expressing human conduct. One of the way of, you know, describing human conduct. And, you know, as we said, we will not go into the details of it because we have been talking about it in quite detail in the previous lectures, you know, from module 1 to 4. So this is one of the view, one of the way of expressing the ethical human conduct. But there can be other ways also, you know, of describing ethical human conduct. So this we have been saying so many times, you know, that when it comes to description of something, there can be different ways of describing, because there can be different angles from where you see and describe. So while the reality is same, the descriptions may be very different, depending upon the angle from which we are seeing it and describing it. So this is view one, that, you know, of describing ethical human conduct. There is another view or another way of describing this ethical human conduct that we want to discuss now. So this ethical human conduct can be further grasped or described in terms of these three things, in terms of the values, policy, and character. So what we have described in one way just now can also be described in another way, and that is in terms of values, policy, and character. And we will see, you know, certain descriptions are important, you know, for certain purpose, while other descriptions may be important when we have some other purpose in focus. So let's look at this, another description of human conduct. So we are calling it view two, you know. So in view two, we are describing the human conduct, the ethical human conduct, in the form of values, policy, and character. So let's look at them one by one, look at the values, then the policy, then the character. So when we say values, this also we have talked about in quite detail, but I can recall them all together here, you know, at least some of the important points here. So this understanding what to do as a human being and what not to do as a human being, right, is the issue of values. So what to do as human being is valuable for human being. What not to do with as human being is not valuable for him. So values has to do with understanding what to do as a human being, which essentially means understanding the role of human being in existence. And this is what we have been trying to do all through these four modules, right? We started with this basic question, you know, what is the role of human being in this existence, right? Which essentially means what are the values of human being, or what is the value of human being in this existence. Now, once we have this right understanding of relationship, harmony, and coexistence, we are able to see our natural participation or values at all levels of being, from individual to family to society to nature and existence. So when we are able to see this harmony at each level, we are also able to see our participation at each level of our existence. And therefore, we are able to see our values at each of these levels. Now, this participation or the human values are definite, and they form the basis of our ethical human conduct. So this is important, that this participation, which we are able to see at each level of this harmony of our existence as a human being, right? These values that we have been able to understand, now they become the basis for our ethical human conduct. And because these values are definite, our ethical human conduct are also going to be different, you know, definite. We have this footmark here, you know, footnote. It says to be able to distinguish between source of continuous happiness and temporary excitement. So this what to do and what not to do, this question is essentially, you know, if you put it in a different way, it means, you know, I am able to distinguish between what is the source of continuous happiness for human being and what is not the source of continuous happiness. So what we call as source of temporary excitement cannot be the source of continuous happiness. So this is another point which we have been making also, that source of continuous happiness is to understand the harmony and to live in harmony. So this is what we have to do, right? What is not in source, what is not as a source of continuous happiness is this, you know, trying to get happiness through some favorable sensation from outside or some favorable feeling from outside. They can be source of temporary excitement, but they cannot be source of continuous happiness. So therefore, what we really need to do as human being is to understand the harmony and have this feeling and thought of harmony, and then to, you know, live with that harmony. And what we do not have to do, so this is what is valuable for us. And what we do not have to do is to run after this, you know, getting happiness or temporary excitement through sensation or through getting favorable feeling from the other. So these values are definite and we can understand it, right? And we understand, when we understand the harmony, we understand our participation in this harmony, our values in this harmony. So in the light of this, we can now see these values, you know, at least briefly place, you know, them here for ready reference. So we said this value of any unit is participation in the larger order, right? And larger order means this larger harmonious systems, starting from family order, you know, to village order, and, you know, so on till the, you know, world order. So you can identify your values, you know, value as a human being, by identifying your participation as a human being in larger and larger system. Right? Larger and larger system. And we had identified these four broadly, you know, the human being, the individual, then the family, then society, then nature and existence. And we want, we can subdivide this human being into self and self with the body. So if you do that, we can see our participation, right? That your value with respect to yourself is your participation in harmony within you, within the self. So this is one value that we have to understand. Similarly, the value of your body is participation in your external activity, right? As a harmonious human being. So first has to do with the ensuring harmony in the self. Second has to do with harmony at the level of human being. And that is the value of your body. So value of the self is to ensure harmony at the level of self. The value of the body is in terms of ensuring harmony at the level of human being. Similarly, value in the family is your participation in the harmony in the family. And so on, right? All these we can see. So in this course, we have tried to explore the universal values of a human being, that is participation of a human being in these different levels, you know, of human existence. And if we try to list them down, we will see in the next slide that we can list down these values. Right? So if we start at the level of existence, we can see this coexistence in existence. So this is what is the relationship. This is what is the value, right? So at the level of existence, you know, we have to understand this coexistence and we have to live in this coexistence. That is our value. At the level of nature, we see this mutual fulfillment. At the level of society, we see all this right understanding, you know, that we have been talking about, right understanding and right feeling leading to happiness, then prosperity, then trust, and this coexistence. So these are the values, basically. You know, these are our participation in, you know, different levels of our human existence. So at the level of existence, we have to ensure this coexistence. At the level of nature, we have to ensure mutual fulfillment. At the level of society, we have to ensure this right understanding, prosperity, trust, fearlessness, and the coexistence. Similarly, at the level of family, what is important is the relationship. And in relationship, what is important is these feelings, you know, feelings of trust, respect, affection, ultimately the love that we have been talking about. So this becomes the value at the level of family, the human value at the level of family. When we look at this in the individual, the level of human being, then this coexistence of this self and body is what is important. And there we said this feeling of self-regulation at the level of self and the health in the body becomes the value for us. And when we look at this at the level of self, right, ensuring this harmony at the level of self is what is valuable, which means ensuring this state of continuous happiness, which is valuable. And this continuous happiness can be seen in terms of happiness, peace, satisfaction, and bliss that we have also talked about. In fact, this details of continuous happiness is basically talking about the details of expression of harmony at each of the activity of the self. So there are different levels of activity of the self. So when we are in a state of harmony at the level of self, you know, we can see certain state of being at each of these levels of activity. For example, at the level of thought, when we have thought of harmony, when we have this harmonious thought, then we are in peace. So this peace is the state of the thought, right? The state of the harmonious thought. Like that we have talked about. So this, at the level of self, what is of value is this continuous happiness, which essentially means understanding of harmony and feeling of harmony. at different levels of activity of the self. So we can see these details and understand these values, you know, which are there, which are important for us to understand and important for us to ensure the fulfillment of this. Now, once we have this clarity about the values, then in the light of these values, we can work out the policy. This policy basically has to do with the thought. So these values have to do with the feeling, the desire. Now this policy has to do with the thought. So thought of how to express these human values, how to live with these human values, that is the policy. So once we have the understanding, we can see the values, we can accept these values. Once we have these feelings, these values in us, now the next question is, how do I go about ensuring the fulfillment, right, of these values? How do we go about ensuring living with these values? That question is answered in terms of thought, you know, of how to go about it. And that is what we are calling as policy. So policy basically has to do with the details. It has to do with the thought of how to do what we want to do. So values has to do with what to do. The policy has to do with how to do what we want to do. The policy is basically the details, the thought of how to do. And this certainly includes plan, program, implementation, results, and evaluation. So all these are the stages. So we first plan how to do things. Then we work out the specific programs in that plan. Then we try to implement those programs. Then we see the results, right? Observe the results. And then we make the evaluation whether this program has been successful or not successful, whether it has been able to achieve the result, the desired result, or it has not been able to, you know, achieve the desired result. And with this evaluation, certainly we will try to make the necessary correction, right? Necessary modification. So all this is included in the thought, in the policy. So the policy has to do with the details of how to do, the thought of how to do, which has to do with this plan, program, implementation, results, evaluation, and ultimately the modification. Now, two things that can be said about this policy is that there, broadly speaking, there can be three types of policy, three types of detailing of how to do. One has to do with the policy for enrichment. Second has to do with policy for protection. And third has to do with the policy for right utilization. So this overall policy can be, you know, categorized in these three: policy for enrichment, policy for protection, policy for right utilization. So this is one observation. The second observation is that when we are thinking of the policy, you know, what is the, you know, thing that we have to deal with? So when we are making policy, this policy has to do with all that we see in the nature, all the units that we see in nature. For space, we don't have anything to do. But for units, yes, we have to do something. So there are, you know, if you look at the whole nature, there are three types of things. One is the self, this units of consciousness. Then we have this body, you know, so when we look at the human being, we have the self and the body, you know, in coexistence. And then we have this physical facility. So all put together can be described in three types of units: the self, the body, and the physical facility. All this we have to take care in policy. So when we are making a policy, right, when we are thinking of how to do things, we have to keep these three things in mind, you know, the self, the body, and the physical facility. So now you can see that we have to have the policy for enrichment, policy for protection, policy for right utilization, right? For all these three things, for self, for body, and for physical facility. So this is a broad, you know, kind of frame about the policy, right? About how the policy would look like. And if you want to give names to this, the policy of enrichment can be, you know, called as human economics. Policy for protection can be called as human politics, and policy for right utilization can be called as human sociology. So sometimes when we talk about this human economics, politics, and sociology, probably we'll try to expand on this. So this is the clue for working out those things. Yes. Next, we can move.
Yeah, I'm going to say it's almost 7:20. So shall we complete this? Or?
I think we will complete it today.
Okay. Okay.
Take up the questions. Yes. So if we now further detail it up, okay, of how to do, you know, then we have these three things: policy for right utilization. This is the priority one. So this is also important. When we talk about enrichment, protection, and right utilization, what is of most importance is the right utilization. And this is what is missing most of the time. Today we are not talking about the right utilization. We keep talking about enrichment, right? We hardly talk about protection. And we almost not talk about the right utilization. But if you look at it properly, you will see that right utilization is the first and foremost thing. And when you are able to see this right utilization, right, in that process, you take care of the protection. And for the purpose of right utilization, you are able to ensure the enrichment. So this policy for right utilization is the first priority. Right? Policy for protection is the next priority, and policy for enrichment is the third priority. But we have to ensure all three of them. We have to ensure all three of them. So when we look at this right utilization of whatever is there in the nature, you know, then one by one we can see that for right utilization of the self, right, we have to have the policy for investing the self for understanding and living in harmony at all levels. So what we have to do at the level of self is to ensure right understanding and right feeling, that is understanding of harmony and living in harmony at all levels. So the right utilization of the self is that this self is invested for the purpose of ensuring understanding of harmony and living in harmony at all levels of, you know, existence of the human being. This is the right utilization. If we are investing the self just for nurturing the body, this is not good enough. If you are investing the self just for, you know, accumulating more and more money, it is not the right utilization. Similarly, the right utilization of the body has to do with policy to ensure that the body is used for ensuring right understanding and right feeling in the self. So the body is used as a means, as a, you know, instrument by the self. Therefore, right utilization of the body would mean that we are able to use the body for the fulfillment of the need of the self, purpose of the self. And what is that purpose? Understanding the harmony and having this feeling of harmony in the self. So the body is a good instrument, right? And the right utilization of the body would mean that the body is used for ensuring right understanding and right feeling in the self, as well as its authentication in living, including behavior, work, and participation in the larger order. So first, the body is used for the purpose of getting the information, you know, and working on those information so that we have the right understanding and right feeling. And once we have this right understanding and right feeling, the body is used to express that right understanding and right feeling in the form of behavior, work, and participation in the larger order. That is the right utilization of the body. And therefore, if you are using the body not for this purpose, but for some other purpose, then it is not the right utilization. Similarly, if you look at the right utilization of physical facility, right, it has to do with this policy to ensure the use of physical facility for nurturing, protection, and right utilization of the body. So the right utilization of the physical facility is in terms of ensuring the nurturing of the body, the protection of the body, and right utilization of the body. Right? And if you look at this right utilization of the body, it has to do with the purpose of the self. So ultimately, the policy for right utilization of physical facility has to do with relationship and societal order. So in order to ensure relationship and the societal order, we have to invest the physical facility, which essentially means that physical facility has to be invested for nurturing, protection, and right utilization of the body, which in turn has to be invested for understanding the harmony and living in harmony, right? Which it would mean understanding this relationship and the societal order, the harmony, and living in that relationship and societal order. So that is the right utilization of physical facility. With this, we can also see this, you know, second and third priority. Can we move on to the next, Rajulji? Yes. So we have this policy for protection, which is priority 2, and we have policy for enrichment, which is priority 3. Right. So we can see all these details. The policy for protection of the self would mean policy for ensuring conducive environment, right, for the self to ensure right understanding and right living in harmony at all levels, right? And protecting from any unfavorable environment. So policy for ensuring conducive environment for the self, that 4 is missing, for understanding and living in harmony. And also protecting from any unfavorable environment. So there are 2 parts. One is providing the right kind of environment, conducive environment. And second is protecting from any unfavorable environment, an environment which is not conducive. The protection for the body, we have to have the policy for ensuring shelter, clothes, and so on, which will protect the body. And when it comes to protecting the physical facility, we have to think in terms of, you know, policy for proper storage, policy for preservation. And similarly, when it comes to policy for enrichment, we have to have the right kind of education, sanskar, for the self. So this right education and sanskar is given to, it has to be given to every child so that he develops this, you know, understanding of harmony and feeling of harmony. So it has to be done with the children as adult education, as education and sanskar. If it is not done for the children, at least it has to be done at the later stage as adult education. And it also has to be done through different efforts at the level of society. Right? So if we look at the society, we have these festivals, these ceremonies, these, you know, functions. And the purpose of these ceremonies and functions and festivals is to develop the sanskar, right? Develop the right kind of sanskar, you know, right kind of understanding and feeling. So enrichment of the self can take place through education sanskar, through adult education, through other efforts for understanding and living in harmony at all levels in the self. So this is what we have to do for enrichment of the self. For enrichment of the body, we have to work out this policy for intake and lifestyle to ensure health of the body. And when it comes to enrichment of the physical facility, we have to develop the policy for production with right process and right skills. So the right process means cyclic and mutually enriching process. And right skills means the skill that human being has to have to facilitate this production, you know, productions which are cyclic and mutually enriching. So this essence is, in essence, is the policy. This, in essence, is the policy. And with this, we can move to this character. I'll just briefly mention it today. Tomorrow, I think we can take some more details about it. So when we have these values in us, and when we have worked out this, you know, policy, the thought of how to express these values, how to live with these values, then what we see in our expression outside is what is the character. So the expression of human values, expression of human values in him, in the behavior, work, and participation in the larger order is what is the character. And this also we have talked about many times, but I'm just recalling them. So this expression of the human values in behavior, work, and participation in the larger order can be understood in terms of these three things, you know, these three following things. One is the rightful acquisition and utilization of wealth. Rightful acquisition and utilization of wealth. And how do we do this? By way of labor, by way of work with the rest of nature, through a cyclic and mutually enriching process. And this also we have talked about. We have talked about in quite detail when we were talking about the harmony in society and where we are talking about this production and work. We did talk about this, you know, cyclic and mutually enriching process which ensures prosperity in human being and preservation of rest of nature. So that is the right acquisition and utilization of wealth when we work with this process, you know, with the rest of nature. Second thing is this compassionate behavior, work, and participation in the larger order on the basis of human values. So we have to have this compassionate behavior, work, and participation in the larger order, right? With these human values. And you can see this work, behavior has to do with, you know, behavior with human being, ensuring justice, ensuring mutual happiness. And similarly, this work and participation in the larger order. There are two things. One is that I ensure the behavior with human being, which is ensuring mutual fulfillment, ensuring justice. But I have to do more than that. And that is the meaning of that compassionate behavior. So the normal human behavior would be, I am behaving with the other human being with right feeling, leading to mutual happiness, leading to justice. But I have to do more than that. When I have this compassion within, that kindness within. And that more is in terms of filling the gaps created in ignorance. So if I have misbehaved in the past, or if other people have misbehaved in the past, and the other person, you know, is already having a doubt, then not only that I have to behave properly, I have to also put additional effort to get rid of that doubt that has been created in him because of the ignorance in the past. So that filling up the gap is also important. So at each of these levels, at the level of behavior, at the level of work, at the level of participation in the larger order, right? We have to take care of what we have to do as human being in the right direction. But we also have to take care of the gap which has been created in the past because of ignorance, because of lack of understanding of this harmony and feeling of this harmony. So these are two things. One is rightfully acquisition and utilization of wealth. Second is compassionate behavior, work, and participation. The third is this chastity in conjugal relationship. That is chastity in husband-wife relationship. So this is the third thing. And these three things are important as our character, important as our expression of the human values and policies. So these human values and the human policies express in terms of this human character, which can be categorized into these three parts. Yes. Can we move to the next slide, Rajulji? I can just sum up. Yeah, next. Yeah. So these are some of the details about this rightfully acquired wealth, you know. And then next, Rajulji. Yeah. So all these details can be, you know, worked out, but I'm not going into the details now. But I will just sum up saying that this ethical, human conduct basically implies that it is naturally acceptable to me and does not give rise to conflict within. Number one. Number two, ethical conduct implies that it is in consonance with the right understanding of the reality. Right, that is in consonance with the underlying harmony at all levels. And number three, ethical conduct implies that it leads to mutual fulfillment with other people and mutual enrichment with rest of nature. Thus, the ethical conduct is self-satisfying. It is people-friendly and it is eco-friendly for all time, place, and individual. So in that sense, it will be an universal, thing, right, showing up in the form of ethical human conduct. So in a sense, what we have been talking about and what we achieve out of this whole discussion is, number one, ethical human conduct emerging out of right understanding leads to harmony at all levels of being, from oneself to family, society, nature, and existence. And we can see that this is definite. It is definite for all time, place, and individual. So this is the essence of, ethical human conduct. This is the essence of human conduct. And as we said, that what is at the base of this ethical human conduct is the human values, the universal human values, which is born out of understanding of harmony at all levels, which is born out of realization of coexistence, understanding of harmony, and contemplation of relationship. So this is, in a sense, description of the ethical human conduct, the essence of ethical human conduct, and description of ethical human conduct. And as we have been saying, that this becomes the guide for professional ethics. That we will talk about in the next lecture. So with this, if there is any urgent question, I can take one or two. Otherwise, we'll take up these questions tomorrow relating to this lecture 24.